When we see someone overweight, there are three reasons most people point to: lack of self-control, genetics, or the environment. But which one is it really? It's clear, obesity is a matter of willpower and simple energy balance. Calories in minus calories out. If you eat more than you burn, you'll gain weight. The average adult needs 1,700 to 2,500 calories per day. If you exceed that, your body stores the excess as fat and muscle. It is therefore the kind of food you eat that makes all the difference. Eating calorie-dense foods with little nutritional value can easily push you into a calorie surplus, as they are high in energy but leave you feeling hungry. Eating plenty of vegetables, whole grains, and nuts makes staying in shape much easier. The logical conclusion is that if someone is overweight, they must lack the willpower to control their diet. And there are countless success stories of people who change their eating habits, started exercising, and transform their bodies. This proves that obesity is not inevitable. It's a deliberate choice, guided by thoughtful decision-making, self-discipline, and the development of healthier habits. But is it a choice that everyone can make? After all, you are what you eat, right? Wrong. Genetics play a massive role. You don't choose your body. Instead, your body may choose for you. Consider this. Genetics influence how fast your metabolism runs, how hungry you feel, and how your body stores fat. The same food can make some people feel fired up because their body uses that energy right away, while others likely feel tired as their body stores the calories in the form of fat instead of using it. And then there are also rare monogenic cases. It is estimated that 2 to 5% of obese people are this way because of a single genetic mutation. For example, the Prader-Willi syndrome results from a gene inactivation on chromosome 15, leading to an insatiable hunger that begins around age 2. Children born with Alström syndrome will be colorblind and overweight, regardless of willpower or lack of self-control. And if your body doesn't produce enough of the hormone leptin, you could overeat simply because you never feel satisfied, no matter how much you consume. Genetics also influence how your body stores fat and whether your metabolism burns calories efficiently. This means that even if two people eat the exact same diet, one may gain weight while the other remains slim. When biology is against you and your body is wired to retain energy, can you really be blamed for gaining weight? Maybe. It's neither willpower nor genetics, but your surroundings that shape who you are. After all, you eat what's available, often regardless of how full you feel. Research has shown that accessibility plays a massive role in our eating habits. One study on cafeterias showed that if fatty foods are moved just a little further from the aisle, consumption drops between 8 to 16%. Another study on college students demonstrated that changing the visibility and distance of unhealthy snacks can decrease consumption sixfold. Portion sizes, which vary widely between cultures, can trick your brain into consuming more than you need. One controlled experiment concluded that increasing portion sizes by 50% for 11 days led to people eating more, regardless of their appetite, and continuing this habit even after the experiment ended. What's considered a large soda in one country might look small in another. Over time, these environmental nudges can lead to significant changes in body weight, which may help explain why Japan has one of the lowest obesity rates in the world, while 1 in 5 children in the US are overweight. And if you study immigrants who move to a new culture, you will see that they adopt the diet of their new home. Research shows that second-generation Asian Americans are larger than first-generation immigrants who stick more closely to traditions from their home countries and eat more fresh and less processed food. The fact that people from countries with lower obesity rates gain weight when moving to countries like the US, Egypt, or Australia suggests that culture plays the major role in shaping your body. As the saying goes, you are the average of the 5 people you spend the most time with. But if the environment dictates the foods you can access, their quantity, and their quality, is obesity in certain cultures inevitable? In other words, if you live in a world where there are only apples, you will probably eat apples. By extension, obesity must largely be a product of the environment you live in, right? Well, it's complicated. Your behaviors around food are often the result of complex interactions between your personality, your DNA, and your environment. For example, your gut microbiome is directly influenced by what you eat and where you live. It then controls how you behave around food and how your body reacts to certain nutrients. If you eat asparagus, it will support the growth of Cristensinella minuta, a bacterium that was shown to promote weight loss and decrease inflammation. A diet rich in fats can increase the presence of Firmicutes, which maximize the extraction of energy, make you crave more, and can contribute to overeating. So, the answer may seem simple. If you change your diet, you change your bacteria, and eventually it becomes simpler, right? Well, yes, but actually no. A study published in Nature, a scientific journal, in 2023 showed that bacteria populations inside our body are associated with certain neighborhoods due to things like pollution, sanitation, or access to good food. This means that even a change in diet may not be enough to counteract genetic or environmental influences. Does this mean that it's useless to even try? No. You can train your brain by developing new habits, even if they seem small, such as starting the day with one apple slice. You can learn about your genetic predispositions and take steps to consciously avoid certain situations. And you can change your immediate environment. Simple rearrangements will reduce your ability to snack. What do you think? Did you know how complex this topic actually is? What about your relationship with food and your own body? Share your thoughts and experiences in the comments below. We relentlessly researched education for the past decade, read plenty of peer-reviewed papers, visited all sorts of schools, created hundreds of videos on the topic, and even set up our very own kindergarten for project-based learning. And now, we also made a book. The Unschooler's Educational Dictionary covers everything we know about learning, unveils the unintended consequences of compulsory education, and includes a complete guide to the alternative school movement. Order your copy now. Just visit your favorite bookshop or check the links in the description below. If you found this helpful, check out our other videos. Join us on YouTube or on patreon.com/sprouts. For more information, classroom exercises, or videos without background music, visit sproutschools.com. Published under Creative Commons.